Penguin Random House Audio presents A Time for Mercy by John Grisham. Read for you by Michael Beck. To the memory of Sonny Mehta, Knopf Chairman, Editor-in-Chief, Publisher. Chapter 1. The unhappy little home was out in the country, some 6 miles south of Clanton, on an old county road that went nowhere in particular. The house could not be seen from the road and was accessed by a winding gravel drive that dipped and curved and at night caused approaching headlights to sweep through the front windows and doors as if to warn those waiting inside. The seclusion of the house added to the imminent horror. It was long after midnight on an early Sunday when the headlights finally appeared. They washed through the house and cast ominous silent shadows on the walls, then went away as the car dipped before its final approach. Those inside should have been asleep for hours, but sleep was not possible during these awful nights. On the sofa in the den, Josie took a deep breath, said a quick prayer, and eased to the window to watch the car. Was it weaving and lurching as usual, or was it under control? Was he drunk, as always on these nights, or could he have throttled back on the drinking? She wore a racy negligee to catch his attention and perhaps alter his mood from violence to romance. She had worn it before, and he had once liked it. The car stopped beside the house, and she watched him get out. He staggered and stumbled, and she braced herself for what was to come. She went to the kitchen, where the light was on, and waited. Beside the door and partially hidden in a corner was an aluminum baseball bat that belonged to her son. She had placed it there an hour earlier for protection, just in case he went after her kids. She had prayed for the courage to use it, but still had doubts. He fell against the kitchen door and then rattled the knob as if it were locked. It was not. He finally kicked it open and it slammed into the refrigerator. Stuart was a sloppy, violent drunk. His pale Irish skin turned red, his cheeks were crimson, and his eyes glowed with a whiskey-lit fire that she had seen too many times. At 34, he was graying and balding, and tried to cover it up with a bad comb-over, which after a night of bar-hopping left long strands of hair hanging below his ears. His face had no cuts or bruises, perhaps a good sign, perhaps not. He liked to fight in the honky-tonks, and after a rough night he usually licked his wounds and went straight to bed. But if there had been no fights, he often came home looking for a brawl.
"The hell you doing up?"
he snarled as he tried to close the door behind him. As calmly as possible, Josie said,
"Just waiting on you, dear. You okay?"
"I don't need you to wait on me. What time is it? 2 in the morning?
She smiled sweetly, as if all was well. A week earlier, she had decided to go to bed and wait him out there. He came home late and went upstairs and threatened her children.
"About 2, she said softly. "Let's go to bed."
"What are you wearing that thing for? You look like a real slut. Somebody been over here tonight?"
A common accusation these days.
"Of course not," she said. "I'm just ready for bed."
"You're a whore."
"Come on, Stu. I'm sleepy. Let's go to bed."
"Who is he?"
he growled as he fell back against the door.
"Who is who? There's no one. I've been here all night with the kids."
"You're a lying bitch, you know that?"
"I'm not lying, Stu. Let's go to bed. It's late."
"I heard tonight that somebody saw John Albert's truck out here a couple of days ago."
"And who is John Albert?"
"And who is John Albert?" asked the little slut. "You know damn well who John Albert is."
He moved away from the door and took steps toward her, unsteady steps, and he tried to brace himself with the counter. He pointed at her and said,
You're a little whore, and you got old boyfriends hanging around. I've warned you.
You're my only boyfriend, Stuart. I've told you that 1,000 times. Why can't you believe me?
Because you're a liar, and I've caught you lying before. Remember that credit card, you bitch?
Come on, Stu. That was last year, and we got through it.
He lunged and grabbed her wrist with his left hand and swung hard at her face. With an open hand, he slapped her across the jaw, a loud popping sound that was sickening, flesh on flesh. She screamed in pain and shock. She had told herself to do anything but scream because her kids were upstairs behind a locked door, listening, hearing it all.
Stop it, Stu, she shrieked as she grabbed her face and tried to catch her breath. No more hitting. I promised you I'm leaving, and I swear I will.
He roared with laughter and said,
Oh, really? And where are you going now, you little slut? Back to the camper in the woods? You gonna live in your car again?
He yanked her wrist, spun her around, threw a thick forearm around her neck, and growled into her ear,
You ain't got no place to go, bitch. Not even the trailer park where you was born.
He sprayed hot saliva and the rank odor of stale whiskey and beer into her ear. She jerked and tried to free herself, but he thrust her arm up almost to her shoulders, as if trying mightily to snap a bone. She couldn't help but scream again, and she pitied her children as she did so.
You're breaking my arms, Stu! Please stop!
He lowered her arm an inch or two, but pressed her tighter. He hissed into her ear,
Where you going? You got a roof over your head, food on the table, a room for those two rotten kids of yours, and you want to talk about leaving? I don't think so.
She stiffened and wiggled and tried to break free, but he was a powerful man with a crazy temper.
You're breaking my arms, Stu. Please let go.
Instead, he yanked hard again, and she yelled. She kicked back with her bare heel and hit his shin, then spun around and with her left elbow caught him in the ribs. It stunned him for a second, did no damage, but allowed her to pry herself free, knocking over a kitchen chair. More noise to frighten her children. He charged like a mad bull, grabbed her by the throat, pinned her to the wall, and dug his fingernails into the flesh of her neck. Josie couldn't yell, couldn't swallow, or breathe. And the mad glow in his eyes told her this was their last fight. This was the moment he would finally kill her. She tried to kick, missed, and in a flash, he threw a hard right hook that landed square on her chin, knocking her out cold. She crumpled to the floor and landed on her back with her legs spread. Her negligee was open, her breasts exposed. He stood for a second or two, and admired his handiwork.
Bitch hit me first, he mumbled,
then stepped to the fridge where he found a can of beer. He popped the top, had a sip, wiped his mouth with the back of a hand, and waited to see if she might wake up or whether she was down for the night. She wasn't moving, so he stepped closer to make sure she was breathing. He had been a street brawler all his life and knew the first rule. Nail them on the chin and they're out for good. The house was quiet and still, but he knew the kids were upstairs, hiding and waiting. Drew was 2 years older than his sister Kira, but puberty, like most normal changes in his life, was coming late. He was 16, small for his age and bothered by his lack of size, especially when standing next to his sister, who was struggling through another awkward growth surge. What the two didn't know yet was that they had different fathers, and their physical development would never be in sync. Heredity aside, at that moment, they were bound together as tightly as any two siblings while they listened in horror as their mother suffered another beating. The violence was spiraling, and the abuse was more frequent. They were begging Josie to leave, and she was making promises, but the three of them knew there was no place to go. She assured them things would get better, that Stu was a good man when he wasn't drinking, and she was determined to love him to better health. No place to go, Their last home had been an old camper in the backyard of a distant relative who was embarrassed to have them on his property. All three knew they were surviving life with Stu only because he owned a real house, one with bricks and a tin roof. They were not hungry, though they still had painful memories of those.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.